Our next speaker, the second for the motion, is a leading Palestinian democracy activist, a member of the Palestinian delegation to the Madrid Peace Conference in 1991, 21 years ago. So it just tells us all how long this has been all going on. He was a presidential candidate in 2005 for that Palestinian leadership position. Speaking for the motion, Mustafa Barghouti.
Well, thank you for inviting me to this debate, and thank you all for coming tonight. There are four reasons why I think Uncle Sam should butt out. The first relates actually, I will be different here from how Jeremy approached the issue. It's about what is the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is. It's not just a dispute between two sides that need mediation or conflict resolution. And you cannot really equate between the Israelis and Palestinians in this case. Today, the Palestinian struggle is a struggle, is a national liberation struggle to liberate ourselves from occupation. It has started as a liberation movement, and now it's becoming a struggle against an apartheid system, very similar to the struggle of the people of South Africa against the apartheid system at one point of time in South Africa. It's very similar today of the struggle of the African Americans against segregation. The United States government and the Congress has very strong strategic alliance and relationships with the Israeli government, which makes them biased to Israel. And that's why they are incapable of supporting the Palestinian liberation struggle, which would be the solution to the conflict. More than that, actually, they are fighting against democracy in Palestine, the same democracy they are calling for all over the Middle East, but not for Palestine. This situation will not change unless we have a powerful and strong grassroots work and movement against occupation, exactly like has happened with the case of South Africa. Today, the United States, unfortunately, is preferring the strategic, military, and political alliance with Israel and its government at the expense of the Palestinian people, but also they are hurting, in the long run, the future of both the Palestinians and the Israelis. Their silence and their incapability to affect the Israeli settlement expansion is practically destroying the two-state solution. The American support, especially the Congress support, to the Likud party and to Mr. Netanyahu reflects a very serious short-sighted policy, because they are opposing the struggle we are conducting, which is, by the way, not only a struggle to liberate the Palestinians from occupation and apartheid. Actually, we are struggling to liberate the Israelis themselves from a settler colonial apartheid system, the last settler colonial system in human history. The second reason is that the United States cannot play a role of an honest broker for many reasons, because of its alliance with Israel first, but also because of the power of the Israeli lobby, or the pro-Israeli lobby. Today, the United States is not like 1956, when Mr. Eisenhower, the president, President Eisenhower, interfered and forced Israel to withdraw from the occupied Sinai and Sector Gaza after the war that was conducted then. At that time, the United States could play that role. Today, it's different, because it is very hard to see a separation between the American policy from the Israeli policy when it comes to the Middle East and when it comes to Israel. It reminds us with what Ben-Gurion said in 1956, when the United States forced Israel to leave Gaza after 6 months of occupation. He said then, "We will never allow this to happen again." And that was the beginning of the build-up of a very powerful pro-Israeli lobby. But the power of the lobby is not only in the fact that it mobilizes votes in the United States. Actually, it mobilizes something more important, which is the election funding machine, something that Jeremy is trying to oppose by creating a different machine. But at the same time, that shows you how powerful this lobby is. Third, the power of this lobby is reflected in the new alliance between the extreme right-wingers in Israel, including Netanyahu, and the extreme neoconservatives in the United States. Actually, since the year 2000, there hasn't been any American independent policy from Israel. They allowed Sharon to destroy Oslo. They were silent about Israel's rejection of the Arab Initiative, Arab Peace Initiative. They allowed Israel, and they took a position against Palestinian free elections in 2006 and against Palestinian national unity. And they stayed silent about the terrible war that Israel conducted on Gaza in 2009, which took away the lives of 1,400 Palestinians, including 440 children. Even when President Obama tried in the beginning of his presidency to stand against settlements and to support the recognition of Palestine and its admission to the United Nations, he was forced, even the American president was forced to retreat, and he was constrained by the Congress, by his own administration, and even by his own party. We're not talking about the United States putting out because we don't recognize the importance of the United States. We're asking for that because so far, all the United States have been doing is being proactive and aggressive, defender of Israeli impunity. And by doing so, it is allowing the destruction of the very last opportunity of peace based on two-state solution, which is going to be harmful to both people. The third reason why I am for this motion is related to the concrete reality. Let's look at the concrete reality. Since the Americans have taken over the responsibility of running the peace process, or the so-called peace process, they've been failing. They failed in Camp David. They failed in Wye River. They failed in Sharm el-Sheikh. They failed in Annapolis. And they failed with the last effort of the so-called Quartet Initiative. The reason is, and the failure will continue, the reason is that you cannot have a solution unless we change the balance of power. And the balance of power today is very much in favor of the Israeli government. The United States does not have the intention or the motivation to pressure Israel to change the balance of power. As a matter of fact, it is only pressuring the weak side, the Palestinian side. In reality, the United States administration and Congress today are part of the problem, not part of the solution. Because one of the main reasons why we have skewed balance of power today in the Middle East is because of the American support of Israel. The United States, Israel is the largest recipient of American aid in the whole world. The United States have provided Israel with American technology to become the third largest military exporter in the world. The United States has the policy of what I call knee-jerk reaction to any effort to criticize Israel in the United Nations or in other platforms. That's why the United States is obstructing what Mr. Obama himself have called for, which is the admission of Palestine as an independent state to the United Nations. Practically, the United States even destroys its own targets. They speak about supporting Mr. Abbas and others in the Palestinian government, but practically they're embarrassing him and weakening him, because after 6 years of being involved in the so-called peace process, he got nothing but a big failure. That's why, because of this American policy, the peace process has become an alternative to peace, not an instrument to achieve peace. The peace process has become nothing but an instrument to keep status quo, and to provide time for the settlement activities which are destroying the very last opportunity of two-state solution. In reality, the United States has been providing an umbrella to Mr. Netanyahu and people like him to compromise the compromise of two-state solution. Finally, yes, we have an alternative, Jeremy. We need an alternative. And the alternative is not to continue to depend on the United States administration, but actually to work in a different way. To follow the same example that the people of South Africa have done. I still remember when 4 years ago I was interviewed on CNN, and they asked me about changing the United States policy, and I said that at that time, 4 years ago, Mr. Mandela, Nelson Mandela, who is the most respected person in the world, maybe, and every American president was trying to get a photo opportunity with him, at that very time, 4 years ago, Nelson Mandela was still on the terrorist list of the American Congress. We will change the situation with an alternative approach, yes, by forcing pressure from sufficient pressure from the people. When we reach that point, when the Palestinian popular nonviolent resistance rises more and more, when J Street can change in reality the opinion of Jewish liberal Americans in the United States, then we can speak about changing the American role. That's why today the best chance to progress forward is for Uncle Sam to put out. We should give an opportunity to an alternative course. We should give an opportunity to the rising Palestinian spring of nonviolent resistance, to the boycott, divestment, sanction campaign, which is growing everywhere, to a true international solidarity movement that supports Palestinians and the future of real peace in the region. We should support a creation of a new alliance between the Israelis and the Jewish people who categorically refuse and reject occupation, apartheid, and racism with us, those who struggle for freedom of the Palestinians, for democracy, for ending apartheid, for true, lasting, and comprehensive peace rather than the illusion of peace. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stephen. We're going to just keep Mustafa Barghouti there for a moment or two while, first of all, you, Jeremy Ben-Ami, a question to Mustafa Barghouti.
Mustafa, you talked about the instrumentality of popular resistance and the instrumentality of BDS as a form of pressure.
That's boycott, divestment, and sanctions for people who are not steeped in this debate as much as you are.
Excuse me for that. What is the goal of those movements? Is the goal a peaceful Palestinian state living alongside the state of Israel? And if so, will that be part of the charter of these movements to make clear that this isn't a threat to Israel's very existence, but is a move towards peace, which is really the goal that we all seek?
Well, we all know that it is already in the charter of this movement, and we all know that even groups like Hamas have now agreed with the two-state solution based on 67 borders. We all know that all the Palestinian movements today and all political parties accept and are engaging in nonviolent resistance, which I personally consider a great success for what we've been calling for 8-10 years. But in reality, I am answering you this. If Israel kills the two-states option, we will continue our nonviolent resistance for one-state solution with full democratic rights for everybody. Israel should not think and believe that if they kill the very last opportunity of two-state solution, we will just submit to apartheid and become slaves of occupation. No, we will continue our struggle. The choice is actually an Israeli choice. And to be frank with you, I don't know whose security is threatened today. Israel is one of the most powerful military forces in the region and in the world. They have 400 nuclear heads. They have a mighty military army. I don't think it is Israel's security that is at risk today. Okay. While every day, we as Palestinians have our security threatened.
Let's have a brief question, brief answer, just from you, Roger Cohen.
Mustafa, you described very movingly the painful reality of oppression for the Palestinians in the West Bank. Nevertheless, in the end, if there is going to be change, Israel has to be persuaded to give up land for peace. How do you imagine Israel, as you just said, faces a choice? How do you imagine that, absent the United States, absent its strongest ally, Israel could ever be induced to take that gamble?
The main reason why Israel continues this existing policy is because occupation has been going on without any costs. It's actually making benefits. Israel makes a profit of $682 million yearly from investment in settlements in the Jordan Valley alone. The confiscation of the land of Bethlehem area alone brought to Israel something like $30 billion. It's a very profitable occupation. The situation will change only when we manage through our nonviolent resistance and with strong international solidarity to make occupation costly.
Thank you, Mustafa Barghouti.
Thank you.
Thank you.